Who am I?
Richard Kazimer, media veteran.
Why I got in radio is because I'm good with a knife.
Contributor in Perth, Australia.
Our friend Richard Kazimer in the United States.
How are you guys enjoying the 19th century? Is that working out for you? How can you say, I'm not making fun of you as a race, I'm making fun of you as black performers?
I think as a country, Americans are as patriotic as the most rabid UK football hooligan.
Who am I?
Richard S. Kazimer. Have we set him Mission Impossible? Nah. Well, I don't think so anyway. Mind you, of course, I've been wrong about that before. Well, not about Mission Impossible, but I've been wrong about things before, so maybe this is one of those occasions when I think we haven't set him Mission Impossible, but we have. Richard Kazimer, good morning.
Good morning, sir. We need a transcript. I have no idea what you just said.
Well, that's all right. I was saying it, so it doesn't really matter. I mean, you weren't supposed to know what I've just said. By the way, if you'd like to be this man's friend on Facebook, Richard S. Kazimer. Kazimer, by the way, spelled K-A-Z-I-M-E-R. Looking at something rather interesting this morning, advertising. And I know sometimes people go, oh, God, I'm sick of advertising. But, of course, one of the things we forget, and I suppose with the introduction of the internet, it's something that has just got bigger and even more broad by definition, and that is the amount of advertising messages that we are bombarded with. We've got them on radio, we've got them on TV, we've got them in the newspaper, they're in billboards, they're on neon signs, they're in the movies before the show, they even appear on your mobile phone and stuff like that. Basically, the world of advertising messages is just everywhere, and as we go on the internet and look on websites, it's now appearing there. Are we suffering advertising and, by extension, information overload?
Well, in the interest of full disclosure and shameless self-promotion, I would add that I'm also an award-winning advertising copywriter. I've won the State of Maine's coveted Broderson Award for radio campaign, which I believe is the equivalent to your AMI awards in Australia. I've also created, written, voice, placed, and print television ads as well. I'm also experienced in marketing and PR. I'm a consultant here in Massachusetts. I've formulated and implemented successful marketing campaigns.
This is his way of saying there is absolutely no way you're going to get an unbiased opinion on this subject. Carry on.
What I'm leading to is, and you thought I was just another pretty face.
I never deluded myself about that, son, trust me.
Whether we like it or not, advertising is an essential part of media and all mediums, and just like you said, including radio, television, print, movies, signage, packaging, clothing. Man, I tell you, if you can stick a message, a sales pitch, or a logo on it, that's called advertising, and somebody is making a buck off of it.
How does it go when you're taking a leak and in front of you is a sign trying to flog you something?
You have a captive audience.
And I think to myself, there is this wall. Whatever happened to good old-fashioned, really trendy tiles in the toilet? No. What we'll do now is we'll put up a little tiny billboard so you're forced to read about our product while you're relieving yourself. And I'm thinking, how far do you go with this sort of stuff? Do people need a point where they can effectively go, Barley's, I just want to get away from this just for a moment? Because with all these new medium like the internet and all that sort of stuff opening up, we are just seeing more and more advertising messages. I mean, it just means that all that happens is you get more shots at people. I'd love to know now how many advertising messages per day the average person is seeing, hearing, or being exposed to versus how many they were, say, even 25 years ago.
I can break it down as to the revenue, because last year was abysmal for the global advertising industry. It was an abysmal year. They dropped 10.2%. This year, though, they're expecting a comeback. Media experts are looking at a 0.9% increase in global ad revenue for about a total of $448 billion in sales. And when I say global advertising, that includes all mediums. The internet is getting another huge piece of the advertising pie. Businesses and individuals are spending about $12.1 billion in online advertising in just the first 6 months of 2010 alone, and that's up from 11.3%. So you're seeing a faster, more productive internet growth in advertising than you are seeing in all the other mediums combined. So people are looking at it, and more importantly, people are responding to it, and that's the true barometer of whether or not your advertising is working, whether it's in front of the urinal or in front of you on the television, is that it's all based on how many people saw the ads and how many people actually acted on those ads and bought the products or services.
Yeah, I was going to say,
it does seem to be working.
Yeah, it's all centered around results. And of course, one of the things that we know is businesses don't just simply spend money. What they do and the way they view advertising is it's called promotion for profit. And they do it on the basis that they believe that it's actually turning them a profit or contributing to their profit. It's amazing, isn't it, that all these different messages that people are getting, you'd almost argue, and I reckon you could just about argue argue in some instances that people would be impervious to them, that they're getting so many messages that they've just simply switched off to them. But the evidence, and certainly the way people are spending, it would suggest that the reverse is true, that in fact the more they're spending to send more messages, the more people are responding to those messages.
You're also hitting more people with the advent of the internet, and then even going back to cable television as opposed to broadcast television, radio, terrestrial radio as opposed to celestial radio, and even to newspaper, is that now you're seeing more and more people being targeted and hit effectively with internet advertising and cable advertising than had ever been before. In not even a generation, but in just a matter of a few years. And so the more people you're saturating, the better your chances are of reaching that target audience and a better chance of getting some results for your advertising dollar. Does that mean it's cheaper to advertise than it was 10 years ago? Absolutely not. The more effective your advertising is, the more effective your advertising medium is, then the more they're going to charge for those rates. One would think that cable television is going to be cheaper than if you bought broadcasting television. It is not. It is very costly, but you get more results and more trackable results, especially on the internet. They can tell how many times somebody hit the ad, who actually hit the ad, how long they were on it, where they went after they saw that ad. So it is very effective. And that's a good thing. We're seeing a lot more ads, but I think as far as the distance and the value of your advertising dollar, it's become very more cost effective for you to advertise in some of the newer mediums that are out there.
Yeah, like I said, okay, we can accept that perhaps, and people might argue that perhaps people like yourself and myself are not necessarily unbiased in this view. I think something that we also have to take into account is the fact that when you look at the average person, and certainly the average person outside of any advertising related industry or any advertising dependent industry, although we could perhaps argue that every industry by logical extension is advertising dependent, but putting that to one side for a moment, many people feel that they just simply cannot escape the constant bombardment of advertising and commercial messages. I suppose we could believe, and there must be a logical argument at some point that says that there might come a point where people will start to, at least subliminally, start to reject a lot of these messages, simply to rebel against them. And that must be a concern to the advertising industry in general, because I can imagine in your country, as is the case here, people do get sick of too much advertising. It does wear them down.
It does. Then you have the option of complaining about it. If a company, XYZ, gets more complaints about their advertisement, whether it's the saturation of it, the quality of it, the message in it, then they change their advertising. It usually falls back on the advertising agency that actually created it. Rarely does a business itself have its own in-house advertising agency. And that's why you see a similarity in a lot of advertising campaigns. It's the same agency doing basically the same thing for a lot of other
companies. I think you might be slightly misunderstanding what I'm talking about there. I'm talking about the fact that regardless of whether the advertising's good or bad, or even if it's in poor taste or what have you, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the fact that just simply the concept of so many different advertising messages coming in so many different forms that people perhaps are arguably starting to switch off to those because they're just simply receiving too many of them, that they're going, nah, too much, and just information overload, and they're shutting down. Is that potentially making it harder for advertisers to get their message across? I mean, are they having to spend more and more to achieve less and less?
Yes and no. Yes, I think they are spending more and more to achieve less and less. And no, I don't think that this is really harming in any subliminal way the general public. You just turn away. It's been so much of our lifestyle from the early 50s and from the early days of television and radio that we just accept it. We do know, the general public does know, that newspapers, radio, television, etc. exist solely as a medium to provide advertisement. The program content is secondary to what the medium does in providing a venue for advertisers to make money. We understand that. Anybody who doesn't understand that, welcome to planet Earth. You know, hope you enjoyed your stay under the rock. But that's just the way it is. And you made a good point, too, about subliminally. It is actually illegal in the United States to do any sort of subliminal advertising at all.
Yeah, what I was talking about when I mentioned subliminal, yes, I do know about subliminal advertising being illegal. What I was talking about was people just subliminally turning off to the whole concept. In other words, the messages that they are getting, they're starting to subliminally turn off to them because they're getting information overload rather than subliminal advertising specifically. And of course, you're obviously referring to the drink Coke, eat popcorn experiment that was carried out, I think it was in the 1960s.
There were some some department stores that used to do that. They would have underneath their Muzak, it would be a voice saying, stealing is wrong. I actually had a couple who owned a small newspaper in coastal Maine one time, and they came in with a piece of music they wanted me to put under their bed for their ad, and they had about 10 seconds worth of copy that said, read the coastal newspaper, and it was just like one-liners, and I started the music, and I hit the stopwatch for 60 seconds, and then the next thing I remembered was 95 seconds had clicked off the clock, and I did it again and again, and I kept zoning out as soon as I hit the music, and then I realized that it was a subliminal message under the music, and we busted these people for trying to do that. To your point, I don't really think so, because I don't think that people are turning off by it. They just turn a blind eye or a deaf ear to it, and whether or not that affects the sales or the quality or the effectiveness of the advertising campaign, I don't think you can really measure it. You can only measure the positive aspect of how many people responded to an advertising campaign from the beginning that the campaign started to when it ended. That's the only real gauge of whether it worked or not.
Gotcha. Do you think there is an argument, and as somebody who's obviously been involved in creating commercials to yourself, I've often thought the answer to this question is yes. Do you think that a particularly bad slash offensive, and of course I realize that offensive by its definition could be subjective, because what one person finds offensive, the next person might not, but putting that to one side, do you think that a bad slash offensive advertisement can have a negative impact? Somebody says, I hate their ads so much, I would never buy their product. Do you believe there's any truth in that statement?
Oh, absolutely. And we have some classic examples here in the United States. One of the most annoying yet memorable ads ever created was Whisk detergent. And it was Ring Around the Collar. And I don't know if you guys had it running down there, but there was a housewife, and she tried scrubbing, she tried soaking, but still she came up with Ring Around the Collar. And it was her husband's work shirt, and it was a white shirt, he was a professional, and he would give her this nasty look, like, you know, how dare you, you know, what an incompetent boob you are. And she was so frustrated, and then she put Whisk around the collar. People were so offended by this ad because it demeaned the woman. It was, you know, it was just really nasty, but it was one of the most effective ads in advertising history because people hated it, but they knew that it was Whisk around the collar.
It's sort of funny how things stick. I mean, I must admit, some of the most successful campaigns we've had have actually sometimes spawned slogans, and that is because it's quite memorable. For example, the Yellow Pages, advertising for the Yellow Pages, the line about Not Happy Jan, which of course centered around a business that realised that they'd missed the deadline for the Yellow Pages, therefore their ad hadn't gone in the Yellow Pages. It was up to Jan to do that. Jan had forgotten to do that, and she decides to run out of the office to get away from the fact that the boss is pretty mad about her forgetting to get the ad in the Yellow Pages in time, and she opens the window and she yells out, Not Happy Jan! And that was one of those lines that people often quote. Even now, people will still say if there's something they're not happy about, they'll say, Not Happy Jan! And it really stems from a very successful commercial for Yellow Pages, who ironically in this country, the Yellow Pages particularly, have run numerous successful campaigns. Everyone in Australia can relate to the Go-Go Mobile. That's G-O-G-G-O, said with a Scots brogue. Once again, it was an advertisement that centred around the Yellow Pages. They have been very, very effective, but they were very clever. I don't think too many people would have ever been offended or thought those ads were silly. I think most people agreed they were clever, and by extension, that made them very, very effective.
Sure. We've had some agencies that have tried to be very artsy. When the Lexus automobile was introduced here in the United States, Lexus did a pre-arrival ad campaign on television where it never said what the product was. It never identified that it was for an automobile. This fell absolutely flat.
Well, it didn't work.
You know what it was? It didn't work at all, because when the Lexus automobile came out, nobody cared. There was no rush to sales. Mm. No one really questioned what it was when they found out.
Yet it's a good vehicle.
It was, but the ad campaign was terrible. So you can have a great product, but a terrible campaign.
Yeah, or
I... What happens when there's a disconnect between the agency and the product, and also the end user? So it doesn't always work, especially from the Young Turks on Madison Avenue that seem to be recycling things from 20 years ago.
By the way, when Richard uses the term Madison Avenue, he's referring to the principal street in New York where the world's top advertising agencies are based. Probably a good idea to point that out. Madison Avenue is by far the most famous. There's no question about that. Overall, is the advertising industry getting cleverer? do you think? I mean, we talk about some of these clever ads, and there's no doubt in my mind, in Australia, the ads that are successful are clever ads. I mean, some ads are borrowed. I mean, I wonder how many people who remember that jingle from the 70s, I love football, meat pies, kangaroos and Holden cars, was actually stolen from a Chevrolet advertisement in the United States. Can you remember how the United States version went?
Something hot dogs and apple pie, or I'm not a football fan, but
Well, actually, the American version went, we love football, hot dogs, apple pie, and Chevrolet.
So,
I mean, obviously, because of the General Motors connection, that's where the sharing came in. But those sort of clever advertisements, they seem to be the ones that work, that have that enduring legacy.
In my case, because I've been so obsessive all my life, and it just drives my wife crazy when I tear apart an ad, is that I've been monitoring. You know, I'm a child of the 50s, so I grew up in the heyday of television and been watching it. And then I got into the industry, you know, in my mid-20s. So I've been following advertising and media pretty much all my life, so it just drives me nuts. Mm. And what I'm seeing, though, is that more recycling, and I don't know if it's due to just osmosis or laziness, but I'm not seeing a lot of new creative ads. I'm actually seeing ads that the parents of whoever is writing it were probably responsible for.
Hey, there's an interesting point. A lot of that happens now with music. I mean, a lot of modern music now is actually sampled from older music, as you'd probably be well aware. Does that mean that there is actually that recycling, and the term you use I think is probably good, does that mean that that recycling mentality probably exists in many different areas? We're seeing recycling effectively in music. A lot of modern music would not exist were it not for the fact that it's sampled older music. So are we not in the whole sphere seeing a form of recycling?
Oh, absolutely. I'm seeing more and more ads relying on music, identifiable music, and not just cover songs, but by the actual artists that are licensing their music to tag advertising campaigns. That seems to be the draw, that if you don't have some creative copy, you can also draw in the audience by playing some very recognizable music or some obscure music. There's a company over here now, and I believe it's a bank that is using some very obscure music by a long-deceased artist named Nick Drake from England. So actually, Volkswagen used his music, and there's a bank that's actually using one of his songs now. Beautiful music by this artist, but it has increased his record sales posthumously. So these advertising campaigns are relying more on modern or very obscure music to promote their ads.
Yeah, very, very interesting stuff. Look, we're out of time as always. Pleasure, Richard. And I must say that advertising is one of those things that we are definitely going to have to come back and have a further look at in the future. There is no doubt about that, because it's so diverse, it's so wide, and we might actually talk about some of the favourite ads, the ads you loved and the ads that you really hated. And that'll be something that we can talk about. By the way, if you'd like to be Richard's friend on Facebook, Richard S. Kazimer. Kazimer, by the way, spelled K-A-Z-I-M-E-R. Is his name, Richard S. Kazimer. He'll be friends with just about everybody. All right, my friend, we'll talk to you next week.
All right, brother, buy something.